foot and mouth call is under scrutiny after the RSPCA revealed it was investigating several cases.
With all.
No.
And he put a nose on his knee.
Really?
It's a modern statement.
It is. I mean, I love the plants. I'm still sort of coming round to the mulch. It's quite strong, isn't it?
The mulch is good. It's worth trying, but.
Have the courage to vote off.
One for the cockle.
Ladies and gentlemen, please on stage the wonderful Roman Keaton. Ladies and gentlemen, Roman Keaton!
Yeah! Coming on stage, yeah!
With his new single, Loving Each Day, Roman Keaton.
By Nescafe.
China. Tonight, America said it wants its $80 million plane back. The former Yugoslav leader Slobodan Milosevic has been ordered out of hospital and back to jail. He'd been complaining of chest pains. The ex-dictator is facing charges of corruption and abuse of power. The man wanted...
I just don't get it.
Easter on...
Ladies and gentlemen,
is a banana.
Whoa, good evening. Thank you. Well, here we are at the London Hilton in the heart of Mayfair for the fourth Cable TV Awards, which, I have to tell you, is now established as one of the major events of the TV calendar. Yes, the great and the good are here tonight. With every winner tonight having been chosen by the readers of the Cable Guide. Yes, can you believe they cast nearly 500,000 votes for their favourites? Now, tonight's awards will showcase the increasing experience and diversity of cable programming. And the first of these is for favourite UK cable personality. Now, here to present this award is one of my favourite people. You know, she was the original supermodel. Since then, she's become a successful film, TV, stage star. And you know what? She is just as gorgeous as ever she was. So please make her very welcome. It's the fabulous Twiggy Lawson!
Nice welcome. Thank you, Dale. Right, the nominations for favourite UK cable personality sponsored by QVC are
Sacha Baron Cohen, E4. Richard Blackwood, MTV.
I make you disappear just like that.
You're going to have one of the biggest funerals in this neighbourhood.
Harry Enfield, Sky One.
We thought Chris's last girlfriend was a bit of a corker, but compared to you, she was a horse.
What did I say?
You marry me. No.
Andy Gray, Sky Sports.
Now, if he's deduced that, then he's wrong again. Because it was a clear goal-scoring opportunity.
Emma Kennedy, ITV2.
Could it be Kevin Webster? Let's have a look what that baby will look like. Oh, dear, that's ugly.
Barry Norman, Sky Premier.
Public's appetite for glossy crap seems to be insatiable. All right, I'll stop beating about the bush. I did not like this movie, and I only hope that dozy lot are paying attention.
Vic Reeves, Play UK.
We all use them. We all need them. For our soups, our beef, and our piss. Urine. What am I talking about? Pots.
Paul Ross, Living.
Hello and a warm welcome to Mystic Challenge, the show that takes a pinch of the paranormal. Do you collect memorabilia, clocks, or your holder?
I only collect money, bubbler.
It's Richard Blackwood.
Well, not only is he a comedian, presenter, interviewer and musician, Richard also has a degree in business and finance. Should come in handy if he wants to get a proper job.
Thank you very much.
There you go, that's yours.
Hasn't got my name in it. Much love to everybody and I hope you enjoyed your chicken as much as I did.
Mm-hmm.
next award is for favourite comedy or drama first shown on terrestrial TV. Now, to present the award, it's Chucky and Angelica, the Rugrats.
That's bossy, Angelica, to you. The nominations for the category of favorite comedy or drama, first shown on terrestrial, sponsored by me, Nickelodeon, are...
Dinner Ladies, UK Gold. Frasier, Paramount Comedy Channel.
You're an architect, right?
No, I'm a psychiatrist.
What are you, Freudian, Reichian?
Well, actually, lately I've been leaning more towards Jung. I guess that's because I'm just young at heart.
Hill Street Blues, Granada Plus.
Do I look like a tight end to you?
I have observed a certain muscularity in that vicinity.
Inspector Morse, ITV2.
Davis gets rid of one rival, only to find...
This part of a job's like being Prince Charming in search of his Cinderella. All that's missing is a glass slipper.
The first phase is to measure the shark's fin with this wire and see if the tag's gonna fit.
It's also a chance to see how they'll react when we attack.
Come to ride.
Well, shalom, mister. Thanks for the ride, the three cigarettes, and for not laughing at my theories on life.
But you broke off right in the middle of it.
About 300...
Here's one of my...
The Skeleton's forces were hunting me down. 1,000,000 blessings upon you for saving my life.
No blessing is necessary. Any four Skeletors is a friend of ours.
Now, why are you so important to Skeletor?
Help me. I'd better show you. Please come with me. I remember the days we didn't have to lock our doors. Those days will come back. Oh, yes. Enter, enter. Come in, come in. Welcome to my home. Come on, huh? Come, come, come. You ask, why is Skeletor after me? Because of my invention. Because of this. Now I wish I hadn't created it. Skeletor wants to be killed, so I can't make another one. If he knew I had this prototype.
Oh, what is it? What does it do?
I call it the Cosmic Key. It is the most unique key in the universe. The tones it generates can open a doorway to anywhere.
Anywhere?
Exactly. One simply computes gravitonic tones for a specific destination, activates the energizer...
And that's how Skeletor's troops got into the city and surprised us.
Yes. Afraid so.
You little worm. Don't you realize what you've done?
Easy, Teela. He didn't know.
That's right. How could I know? We Tenorians are a peaceful race, trusting in every way. A woman came to see me. Said she heard about my fame as a locksmith. She seemed interested in my work. How could I know she was from Snake Mountain? She was beautiful.
That would be Evelyn.
She tricked me. She stole the key.
Gwildor, can this device of yours get us to Grayskull?
Certainly.
To the sorceress?
those were the first coordinates I calculated before she came.
Okay.
Oh, but we can't. If we disturb the gravitonic waves, Skeletor's key will locate us.
Sounds like he's already located us.
Designed for...
with their emphasis on customer service, has had...
You, I feel a little bit closer to home, and...
Oh my God, please don't cry. Come here. I can't.
All of my kisses, you don't know what you've been of it, oh boy. When you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that the world is for me. All of my life, I've been waiting, and I there'll be no hesitating, oh boy. When you're with me, oh boy, I thought the world could say that the world is for me. Stars, too, and a shadow.
Event, if that comes.
Of not having the same sort of bounce they did in the first round. And I can't see the clock to see how long we got left. That looks to be the end of the bout. This is a welcome change to the format, and I know what they do in some of the big shows in the UK is they tend to have a fight off between two or three teams, with the eventual team winning a
unpleasant one. Yes.
So what's your feeling about her?
Bad seed and big trouble, and in terms of
it was the lifetime.
Ceremonies. The press are at the hospital gates. So far, they've been kept at bay. They don't get stories like this every day. They want to know just how you feel after being attacked by a tiger.
A bit rough. Yeah, part of that. Okay. The trouble is the fingers hurt. Still, even though I haven't got any. That's the main thing.
So, what actually happened here, sir?
I was just opening the slide, and to get the slide open, you've just literally just got to nick a finger through. And when I've nicked the finger through, it grabbed the fingers and pulled us in and proceeded to work my way up its arm. Nice friendly animal, but they're wild, tame wild. So,
mind the people, Matthew, Joseph, be careful.
Keith Willett was one of the surgeons who revolutionised the trauma team. He spent 6 years in Oxford with his family.
My wife, Leslie, and I've got five children, ages from 2 to 13. Sam is 13, Sarah's 11, Joseph, who's 8, Matthew, who's 5, and Rachel, who's making all the noise, who's just coming up 3.
Hey, fit you?
Yeah.
In the middle of a hectic week, he's in charge of another major operation on the family home.
Not fixed. Yeah, right, that's better. Keeps the wife happy.
There's a combination of performance and style of shooting.
I think that I have learned more about filmmaking and seen it done at its very best.
That's what we're view here are saying, that it would have been practically...
Do you know what happened to me?
You're holding a real sword.
Well, you first...
Trace, I'm done with that!
Okay.
Which one of you boys in charge?
And the pins work their way in with...
Not on!
I know, this is a funny like a thing!
Percent off all bath suites.
Think you ever did it, Leslie?
Saved me.
Starting.
Under. You hear me?
And a human? I'm begging you, never do that to anyone!
The Sky World package before the 24th of April, you'll...
And everyone came in.
9% of the people are blonde, and you know, most people are, you know, of a reasonable intelligence.
But as I said in the introduction, I mean, you've lived out your life, you seem to, in tabloids. I mean, there was, I mean, the good and the bad. I remember your a news story about your varicose veins, for God's sake.
Do you know, it was we'll not have a shot of this, but no. It was only a few weeks ago, actually, yes, and this is the first airing my legs have had
really?
Since the operation.
And,
yeah.
And where were the varicose veins? Somewhere where you couldn't show them on this family show.
The legs and one other area,
oh,
yes.
Oh, really, really. But, I mean, that sort of tabloid interest... Classic giggly laugh. That sort of tabloid interest, does it bother you? Do you court it? Do you want it?
No, the strangest thing is that I don't think I've ever... I know I've never actively generated a story. I've never gone out of my way. I mean, I live not far from you, out in the country, and sort of tuck myself away. I don't go out very much, and it seems that if I do go out, it's kind of big news, or if some... How on earth stories like that come out? I guess, at the end of the day, you're on a list somewhere, on a medical list or whatever else. Someone somewhere finds out and wants to tell somebody. But I'm never ashamed. I mean, I'm not sort of... I wasn't ashamed about that, certainly, not having my varicose veins. Go and have it done, girls. It's it's all the rage. And you have lovely bruised legs for about a year. But apart from that, no, so I don't know where it comes from, and it surprises me and it shocks me every time it happens. I also sort of... I have an image of myself as not being known and sort of as just being Ulrika Johnson, and then when I go outside, it's other people who remind me that, you know, who either wave or say hello or ask for an autograph that remind me that I am actually...
But I mean, you I suppose one of the great interests in you are the men that you choose in your life. I mean, you've chosen one or two dillies, haven't you, in your... I mean, let's talk about Stanley Collymore as one. I mean, he was a guy, I mean...
Well, I'm sure his mum loves him.
Well, I'm sure she does. He had a curious way of showing that he loved you because he beat you up.
He did.
Now, that was done in a public place. I mean, you were to know, of course, he was going to beat you up. I'm not saying that at all. But, I mean, what happened in any case? I mean, what was the story behind that?
Well, I guess the bottom line to that whole story is that nobody knows the full story. And for me, the worst thing was not actually what happened in Paris. It was the psychological abuse, that sort of an emotional abuse that went on before all that. So to me, again, it wasn't something that I was expecting anyone to find out about. I mean, I know it was in a bar, in a pub, but I had no idea it was coming.
No, you weren't sure you were going to get me.
And
of course not.
And I think it was... It all happened very quickly, so I had no conception of sort of... I just wasn't expecting it. It was a very volatile relationship, to say the least. Not because I feel that I'm particularly volatile, but I think the other party was, and that contributed to a situation that was, at some stage or another, whether it was me or another person, was probably inevitable.
Why don't you prosecute him?
I just never even thought about it. My most immediate thought, ironically, after the event even, was, is he going to be all right? Because the press were just going bananas.
Is he going to be all right?
Yes, I know, it's mad, isn't it? That's how I used to think, and that's
14-stone football, they can be fairly good at it, beating up.
Yes, and in fact, I have to be grateful for the fact that it did happen in a public place, because I think, you know...
It could have been worse.
It might have been worse.
He has apologised, I hear, in an issue of a magazine lately.
That was nice.
Wasn't it nice of him? Big of him. Well done, Stan. But, I mean, would you say, generally speaking, that you have an unfortunate taste in men? I mean, has that been...
I guess you might be right, yes. I think I tend to be very forgiving, and I tend to be very, very trusting.
They're all nice things to be, aren't they?
Yeah. Seems to get me in a bit of a pickle, though.
let's talk about the thing that must concern you most of all now in your life, and that's your baby. We've read the stories about the baby's problems. Just for anybody who doesn't understand what the situation is, to tell us exactly what the problem has been and what the situation is now.
Basically, at my 5-month scan, which is the big scan that all pregnant women go to, where they check heart, kidney, livers, and whatever else, they couldn't quite see the four chambers of the heart. And I thought, oh, that's all right, because I can hear the heart beating. So, and the baby's kicking away, so that's fine. We went on to discover that, in fact, she has a condition called double inlet left ventricle, which basically means that... It's very, very complicated, but basically means that her heart's very, very messed up. It's a fairly major defect, on top of which I was at that stage told as well, based on no medical evidence, really, that there might be a chromosomal link, and which might mean that the baby wouldn't be compatible with life, and I'd have to consider a termination or whatever else. We discovered then that that wasn't the truth, and in fact, she was born at Guy's Hospital, where after 6 days she had a first of three operations, and the first operation was a closed heart operation, which means that they keep the heart going while they're doing this little, putting a little banding around her pulmonary artery, and she's due to have, she needs to have two more surgeries, and they both will be open heart.
Much later on in her life?
Well, one will happen presumably within the next few months. Yes. We're just waiting to see how her growth, how she develops, and how big she gets, because that'll be a sign that she's outgrowing this present operation.
And if everything goes according to plan, will she lead a normal life? Is that the prognosis?
That's the hope, yes. I mean, they're very, very serious operations, and they say that these babies shouldn't be wrapped in cotton wool. They should be treated as normal babies, and thankfully I had a healthy son 6.5 years ago, so I kind of felt quite secure when I took her home that I knew the signs for a normal baby,
yes,
but you
yes.
do get slightly paranoid. She gets quite breathless quite easily. She's starting to look a bit bluer in her face, which is one of the signs that she's starting to outgrow the present operation. But she's just like any other normal 5-month-old. She laughs, surprisingly. She has a sense of humour, thankfully. And she's just cute and very bright and very, very alert, and she doesn't sleep during the day, but she's quite good at night.
And then, of course, you had this other terrible thing happen to you, because your partner, the father of the child, left you.
Another nice man.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? I mean, he just walked out.
Yeah, that was in some respects totally unexpected, because we had planned to have a child together, and he was very, very keen for us to have a child together. So it was literally the day before I was due to take her home from hospital, he announced that he needed to consider his career, which would take him to faraway countries. So,
which did not include you or the baby?
Seemingly not, no. And I've never understood it, and I went through a very, very terrible depression, which I think I'm only just really started to come out of in the past month or so.
When you went into trying to understand it, did you come across other cases? Did you find out that it was not a common thing, obviously, but it did happen before?
Well, it's almost as with the heart defect that my daughter has, I had so many letters from members of the public,
sure.
And most of which I haven't answered yet because I've been busy with another project, but also I was too incapable of doing anything. I couldn't walk from one end room to the other without feeling like I might collapse or just roll over and die. And I had a lot of letters when that news came out because I was suffering with that knowledge that he'd walked out, but nobody knew, of course, at that stage. And so as soon as that came out, a lot of letters from women whose partners had walked out as well. And, you know, I'm not the first woman that it's going to happen to, and I probably won't be the last.
Under your circumstances?
Not with sick children, perhaps, but certainly with a similar situation. Yeah. Or as soon as the child comes along. So.
You must have a very low opinion of men, actually, I would think.
Strangely enough, I don't. I think that you can't tar everybody with the same brush, and I think I love men. I love the company of men. I love the company of women. So, and finally, I'm beginning to get my sort of enthusiasm for life back now. And I don't think I have much energy just at the moment to sort of be looking for a man. Strangely enough, and I don't know how trusting I would be now.
These
various experiences. But
you're writing a book, aren't you, about all this? It should be a fascinating book, because I'm sure there's an awful lot you're not going to tell me tonight. And in fact, therapeutically as well, that would be best if you just sat down between yourself and the page itself.
Well, that's how it started about a year and a half ago. I found I'd sort of lost my enthusiasm for TV. I didn't know who I was anymore, because the person that I was reading about in the newspapers wasn't me at all, and things were being written that absolutely, categorically weren't true or weren't right, and they still upset you. You still can't seem to consolidate those things, the private person that you are and the person that everybody else perceives you to be. And I was really getting, I felt very unsure of myself, didn't know what was going on, and I just knew I wanted to sit down and just take myself through my life, my childhood, everything, just to find out how I felt about those situations, who I really am.
Are there any clues in your childhood to the
choice of men?
Yes, indeed. That kind of situation that you found yourself in. Are there any?
I don't know. I think I've always been very scared of people leaving me or getting up and going. But it's never made me cling on to anyone. Strangely enough, I don't think. But I think it's certainly made me somehow have a weird sense of good choice. I don't have a very high opinion of myself, and therefore I always place myself with people who perhaps don't treat me as well as I.
It's interesting, as I think a lot of people were looking at you and looking at how you look on the television here, and thinking, well, God, if she doesn't have any sort of self-esteem, I mean, who does? You know, it's remarkable, isn't it? People often make that mistake. I think with very attractive people that they believe them to be much more than they are.
Yeah, perhaps because of the job that I do as well, which seems to be very glamorous, and it's all fun and laughter, and it's lots of money, and it's fantastic, and isn't it great? And really, the things that happen to me happen to everybody else who's sitting out here, and you go through extreme highs and extreme lows, just like everybody else.
So this new show that you're doing called Dog Eat Dog.
Yeah.
This is one of those confrontational programs, is it?
No, I think it's rather nice, actually.
You have, six people?
Yeah.
And you give them tasks to do.
Yeah.
Against, they can set a task for somebody else.
Well, we set them tasks in the studio, and they've really only known each other for 24 hours before, where they've gone off on an assessment, tested their physical ability, their mental agility, and then we put them in the studio and we ask them basically to vote for the person who they think is going to be the most rubbish at that particular event, to eliminate them or to sort of get rid of them so that we're down to one person at the end.
You don't wink at the camera like that.
No, I don't wear glasses at the end of my nose.
You are the weakest thing. And so when you get your life together, what?
There's no hope for that.
No. There's no. You think you're prepared for a sort of more chaos, are you?
And more
adventures along the way.
No. Well, probably. I mean, there's no point. This is the thing with me, is that I've always thought there's extreme highs and extreme lows, and I can't cope with this, and I'm in the wrong business. I should be doing something very stable and calm, whatever else. But life is never going to be like that. I think most people understand that life is quite difficult, you know, and that's always going to be the case, that it's always going to be highs and lows, and I just have to try and tailor myself to that a bit more.
All right, well, much enjoyed talking to you. Ulrika Johnson.
Stylish siblings in pop. Their second album, Talk on Corners, was the biggest selling album of 1998, bringing them fans as diverse as Mick Jagger and Luciano Pavarotti. Here singing So Young from it, please welcome The Cause. Thank you. more music from the Chords later on in the show. Now, my next guest makes multiple personalities his living on his television show Alistair McGowan's Big Impression, which starts a new series a week on Sunday. He becomes David Beckham, Terry Wogan, Robert Williams, Woody Allen, anyone else he cares to lampoon, including someone not a million miles from this studio.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jerry Hall!
Now, Jerry Hall, you're better known, certainly to people in this country, as a model, and as Mick Jagger's, ex-wife. But recently you've been acting in the West End, haven't you, in The Grudge?
Why am I laughing, ladies and gentlemen? Alistair McGowan. Yeah. He's done it again. I hate him. That's the one thing I hate. I don't mind the impression. He said, when he does that with my... Look, I don't... You can't see my whites. No. It's very vulgar, Alistair.
We do the same with Richard Madeley, actually, now.
Do you?
Yeah. He's got very long arms, so we lift his shirt cuffs up a bit. So
Richard Madeley is one of my favorites. We're going to show that, actually, clip in just a moment. He's one of the new ones, isn't he?
He's one of the new ones, there's a few new ones this time, and a few old favourites.
So, let's talk about the new people then. One new guy, an old guy, you must have been doing years and years ago, Jimmy Savile.
Yeah, Jimmy is somebody that, over the years, I suppose he's somebody, really, who, most people probably can do, yes indeed. And all that stuff back in the 70s, I think Mike Yarwood did it, didn't he?
Everybody did.
Had a couple of good ideas for him, and he was on this Louis Theroux, I think is a fantastic, what do we call him, reporter, presenter, whatever he is, Louis Theroux. But he was on that, and he just seemed to have been around a bit more lately, so we thought that Jim was perhaps the man, to do a little bit of something for. And also, it was great for me, you say, because you always look now to see who you look like. And I saw a picture of Sir James with his hair, and I thought, blonde wig, and my nose, my big brown eyes, that will do fair enough, you say. So he's in it. He only does a couple of sketches, though, but yeah, he's in there.
What about the physicality there? Because doing myself or doing Jimmy Savile, you can get away with it, but what are the ones that you find difficult?
Well, it's easier, really, to do older people or people who've got beards or something that you can put on and be identified by. It's the younger people who are the hardest to do. I mean, last series we had some stuff written for Michael Owen, for example, and, I could do the voice of Michael, so I thought maybe we could do Michael Owen, but it was just really difficult because you just had nothing to put on, so, you can't make yourself look that shiny. And,
last week you had Robbie on, didn't you?
I did.
His very chair. Yeah,
that's right.
And he was another one. We had him on last time, did some sketches with him, and you can do the voice, that's all right, it's not bad, is it?
But you just couldn't. We had this lovely song, well, I thought it was a lovely song that I'd written for Robbie, about how, I don't know if you've noticed this, but when he walks around, he sticks his bum up a bit like that, doesn't he? So I had this thing about him being like a monkey, and I'd written this whole song about Robbie Williams and his simian ways, and it included the line, and so it's my prognosis that I am part proboscis, which I thought was the best thing I'd ever written.
You mentioned there the way that he walked reminded you of an animal. In fact, I believe that lots of, you get a clue, don't you, to people by associating them with an animal. And how does it work?
Well, someone like Robbie, obviously, there. And it initially started with me years ago when I was working on the comedy circuit. I used to do Moira Stewart, who I haven't done in this series. But the thing with Moira is that it's just a vocal thing. Is that she always sounds to me like she swallowed a fly. So it can help the sound sometimes, like with Wogan as well, is another one where the sound, I described it, and I suddenly thought, what is it? And I thought, he's like a rabbit trapped within the body of a killer whale. So if you think of Wogan, he has this little voice like that, doesn't he, when he's presenting and so on. There we are, yeah, like a little rabbit there looking at the headlights, and then suddenly he'll start to grow and go like that, see? And you realise that there's those two things working together. But sometimes it is the physicality, like with Dot Cotton, it's that kind of neck, really, isn't it? It's all sort of, it's a bit like a tortoise or one of the little dogs you see on computers whose necks go like that, little wobbly dogs. But it's like a tortoise, really, it just keeps coming out and going back in again. Sorry, Mark, what you were saying, darling.
It's very brave you doing Doc Cotton. It does work.
Well, I was really pleased with that.
All right, let's have a look at a clip, actually. Let's have a look.